Are we starting now? All right. My name is not Danny Mac. Legally, it's Dan Fowley. I thought it'd be good to do a documentary on the history of Pavonis.
Pavonis.
The reason the story should be told is because there's so many myths of how Pavonis started and who founded it and, you know, what's it all about. I invested whatever I had to carve that place out of the jungle.
Danny's a really dynamic person who changed the course of a country in a way.
He's a big dreamer.
Like everyone says, it's one of the top 10 waves in the world.
The wave was amazing.
They call it Danny Land. Wow, what a spot. We moved right into Pacific Beach in 1940. First time I saw the ocean, I wanted to get into it. I started diving abalone when I was 12 years old. We'd sunk a couple of barrels out of Crystal Pier. It was a candy store. You got to think like a fish to be able to catch them. I made more money than my dad. He didn't like that very well. I'm a waterman, that's what I am.
Danny was respected by his fellow watermen, known amongst the hardcore guys as being one of them. He was a local folk hero.
When I grew up in San Diego, there were 50 surfers on the whole coast. I think we knew every one of them, from Tijuana Sloughs to Steamer Lane.
You felt like you were in on a secret that the rest of humanity didn't know.
We'd see each other coming up and down the coast and wave each other down, you know. Hey, how is it up there, you know?
I shaped Pat Kern, his first surfboard, up on Ingram Street. I shaped, like, Mike Diffendorfer's first board. It was the octopus board.
Guys like Danny and his friends were the pioneers.
I went over to Hawaii, I think it was in 1951, and I was fascinated over Makaha. And you had to make a board just for those big waves, and I would shape them right at Waikiki Beach.
He just got tagged as the godfather, kind of like, you know, because he had a rep that was just amazing.
1954, I made the cover of Sports Illustrated.
The time that he came out of was just a time we'd all love to go back to as surfers. Danny was, in his very heart and soul, a surfer. And when he found Pavonis, he found a spiritual haven for himself.
I had a pocket full of money from the handbag business. And for years, I wanted to buy a good surf spot. My daughter loved horses, my son loved surfing, and the other one, motorcycles. That's why I headed that direction. I wanted to see a new place. I sold everything off, had it all in cash, and I brought it to Costa Rica.
And when he landed, what he saw was a world-class left and no one there.
Well, there are only 35 families that lived in a stretch that was 20 miles long. The forest was emerald green. It had birds, parrots, monkeys. There's no way to get there except by boat. So I cruised the bars and asked, who owns this property out here? His name was Cuyo Lobo. He had 250 acres there, and he had a kind of a Mickey Mouse sawmill and a perfect wave in the front. We wrote the Compraventa right in the bar that night, and it's now called the sawmill.
When he pioneered Pavonis, the local people loved him because he was generous with them.
Thanks to Danny, we have connections with doctors. We got electricity. He brought a lot of hope.
I treated them all like my family. I put everyone to work. I built all the roads, the bridges, the churches, the school, and I taught all those guys how to drive tractors and build houses. We did a lot of farming there.
We learned from him. Our nature can give us more than what we expect, like a beautiful wave.
He wanted somebody there to share that wave, to be a part of history, in fact.
It was prior to Tavarua, prior to G-Land. Pavonis was a very exclusive private club. He had to be invited by the patron.
I was totally amazed of coming off that plane, getting picked up by a tractor. It totally blew me away.
Not a whole bunch of people knew about it, so I felt really privileged at the time. It was an experience I'll never forget, you know.
He would make me laugh up and down that beach.
I can remember Button saying, "Gee, bro, that's the best wave I've ever been in."
I was doing backside 360s, frontside 360s. My time in Pavonis is going to be in my heart forever.
The wave is so mechanical and so machine-made.
You can ride until you can't stand up, and the water is 75 degrees.
After a nice long ride, it was good to have the cantina to slide by and get a bottle of beer, run back up the beach, and surf back down. That was for my friends and myself.
It was awesome. I mean, everybody looked up to him like a king.
There was this Danny world down there. His reign from being a diver and an abalone guy and a waterman to some kind of underlord, went through that naive period, and the players in that scene turned gnarly, and the reality of it just came crashing in on him.
What did I do wrong? I got mixed up with people that trafficked marijuana, and I ended up in a marijuana conspiracy.
They never caught him with anything illegal, but everything added up to everything, and they knew he was guilty.
When he went to prison, nothing was the same. Everybody was sad and shocked for the accusation.
His whole thing was bullshit and conspiracy, and a lot of people took rides on him just to put him away.
When he left, the poachers, the greed, the gringos were sucked into that Shangri-La.
The squatters, they pretty much Americans.
I was away a long time, and all the land sharks moved in there. They're selling my property and getting rich.
It's not about drugs. It's about thievery and money. And now that they have me exiled, I still can't come back and defend my property.
You cannot strip a man from what he's done for the people. By right, what's his is his. He should have it. He should have it, no matter what.
The newspapers like to sensationalize the Danny Mac stigma. They can never mention me without saying ex-convict, narco-trafficante.
There is trepidation and fear on the part of people who have taken his land, and I think that drama continues to unfold.
People always like him to come back so he can finish his dream.
I'd like to tell the story so people understand what happened there, what really happened. I'd like to let somebody really see who I am.
His life is abstract and bizarre and violates all our sensibilities. He's a very powerful guy.
People refer to me as the King of Pavonis.
The King of Pavonis.